So we now have the basic idea. Now this idea has to be implemented in practice, but since we are dealing with very large numbers, the implementation is not so straightforward. Let's see what complications arise. The crux of RSA is n, which is the product of two prime numbers p and q, and everything else revolves around n. So how does one come up with prime numbers? There is no easy way. Typically, the way it is done is you choose a random number and test whether it is prime or not. But unfortunately, there is no practical way to determine if a number is prime. But there are fast and efficient probabilistic algorithms that can tell whether a number is prime or not. What probabilistic means is there is still a very small probability that this number is not prime. But what is that small probability? For example, if you use this Miller-Rabin test, the probability of whether it is prime or not is something like this. As you can see, this is an extremely small number. If it said it is not prime, that means it is with probability also close to 1, it is not prime. So this is how you find what n is. Choose random numbers, pass them through this Miller-Rabin test. If it says it is a prime, take that number, take two such numbers, multiply them to get hold of n. So that is how to choose prime numbers. But you require a few other things also. You also need to ensure that e is relative prime to this Totian function, which is nothing but the product of these two. Now, how do you ensure this? Now, e, it is useful if e were a small number, because if you see, we do this operation m raised to the power of e, and if e were small, your encryption will be very fast. So for now, I will just mention that if e were 3, you just require two multiplications in the encryption process, and if e were the 65,537, you require just 17 multiplications in the encryption process. Why like this? It will become clear shortly again. So it's good if you choose these values. These are quite popular. These are also used in practice. Now, if you were to choose this e, how do you, so you are fixing e now. Now, how do you ensure that this e is relative prime to phi n, which is nothing but a function of this p and q? So one way this is often done is the following. Suppose you chose e is equal to 3. It can be shown that if you chose p is equal to some random number into 6 plus 5, this will be relative prime to e. So what you do is you choose some very large random number, multiply it with 6, add 5, and then pass it through this primality test to see if it is prime. If it turns out to be prime, you retain that p. Similarly, you do for q as well and take their product. That will ensure that this e is going to be relative prime to the Totian function. So that is how you go about starting with a fixed e. You determine primes that are, in fact, p minus 1 should be relative prime to e. Based on this, you decide p should take this particular form and then check whether it is prime or not. So here, there is one other thing for you to note. If e were 3, it does not weaken security, but it is essential that the messages be padded with random bits. Why do you think it is like this? That is because when you do m raised to the power of 3 mod n, and if your message size is very small, you can easily do this inverse because you already know n. Only if the message size is very large, where when you are doing m raised to the power of 3, where that m raised to the power of 3 exceeds n, then you cannot do the inverse. So if m inherently is a small number, you should pad it so that you make it a very large number. You know your padding, so you can remove the padding later and thereby ensure that you cannot inverse this particular function. Okay, that is with respect to computing computing the GCD, that is choosing E relative prime to phi n. To decrypt, you also need to calculate D, and D, as I said, has a relation that ED should be 1 mod phi n. This is the inverse operation. So in order to calculate D, you essentially have to do a modular inverse, but this can be done efficiently using something called a Euclid's algorithm. So again, there are ways to do this. So this is not so difficult once you know phi n. So far, we have seen how to generate the keys, how to you fix E, you can calculate D using this Euclid's algorithm. We also determine how to calculate N with this P into Q, where this relation between E and the totient function is maintained. This is all with respect to generating keys. Now, how do you use the key? When you are using the key, you essentially have to do this computationally intensive operations, m raised to the power of e or c raised to the power of d. Just to be clear, this operations are lot less intensive than generating the key, thankfully, because generating key you only need to do once, whereas this you have to do often. So it is good that they are computationally less intensive. Generating key is very intensive because you are dealing with all those primality testing, multiplication and so on. Now, when you are doing these calculations, as you can see, if you were to go with some very naive approach, you are essentially doing, for example, if you are doing C raised to the power of D, D, as I said, is an extremely large number. You are multiplying C D times. Okay, this is, it requires D multiplications if you went for a very naive approach. Can you think of a better way of doing these multiplications that will result in a faster processing? Well, this approach, the efficient approach, is called repeated squaring, where you determine C, C square, C to the power of 4, C to the power of 8, C to the power of 16, so on, all in modular n. And you take the binary representation of this number d, and multiply only those C's that are whose positions correspond to 1 in the binary representation. I think an example will make this clear. Suppose we want to calculate C raised to the power of 43. 43 is a small number here. This is just because this is an example, but this can be a very large number. This D can be a very large number. Now, if you represent 43 in binary, this is what it is. You already have done the calculation of C, C square, C4, C8 and so on. This you have already done. This binary representation results in this multiplication. So all in all, with just 4 multiplications as opposed to 43 multiplications, because the value of D is 43, you were able to calculate this particular value. So this number of multiplications you are doing will be proportional to what of D? That is right. It will be proportional to the number of bits used to represent D, that is log of D. So this is an efficient way to do this encryption and decryption operation. So this RSA implementation is intensive but manageable. So now that we have covered implementation aspects, let's look at, are there any attacks possible on this RSA public key algorithm? And if they are possible, what are some possible best practices to prevent them?